People associate security with threats. And the world today is prone to threats that go beyond physical attacks. Today, we are vulnerable to feel secure about personal and professional privacy and safety. To feel secure, one should be secure. Garden City University recognizes this urgent need for awareness and action with regards to securing our lives. For this, various schools of the university have come together to form a stage of students, academicians, and industry professionals to exchange ideas and debate in the various areas of study to provide results that could create awareness among people.
On this note, I welcome our dignitaries, panelists, and dear guardians to the conference.
Thank you to all the dignitaries for being here today, but most importantly, to all you students out there. I have a son who's 20 who's studying computer science, and a daughter who's 21 studying business finance. So I know what you're all going through, and I really have to restrain myself from going, woo, wake you all up, come on guys. Okay, so we do have a PowerPoint presentation. If somebody could put that on, that'd be great. So often when people think about the United States military, they think about reactions to provocations, bombs, and war. And many people don't realize that the United States spends much of its time and treasure preventing war, stabilizing governments and economies, and building relationships around the world. As I served as executive trustee on the Military Foundation Board at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, I came to learn so much that few people in the world actually know about. I want to share some of this information with you so you have a sophisticated global vision of what goes on behind the scenes in international security. Also, as a potential for you to adapt some of the successful military strategies to secure your own growth and own lives and careers, and also to train your mind as visionary leaders are trained. Before I start, I want you to get into the frame of mind of a leader, of a visionary, so you can take as much as you can from this, whether it pertains to your career or not. Imagine you were told you were going to become the mayor of this city next month. Did you feel a sense of excitement or stress? How would you prepare? What would you do? Leaders don't just walk down a street not noticing anything. They walk down the street and notice the infrastructure, the services, the culture of the people. They are constantly curious and think about the gap between what currently exists and what is possible in every area. So everything around them becomes a lot more important and exciting. So now on to global leaders. Would any of us imagine what these following people would have in common besides being global leaders? President Dwight Eisenhower, the Prime Minister of Singapore, Indonesia's President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, General Petraeus, the King of Bahrain. How about Colin Powell or the President of Rwanda? What would they have in common? Amazingly, all of these leaders have lived in Kansas City in the heartland of America for a year or two with their families. Who knew? And these are just a few names in a long list of leaders from around the world that have lived in Kansas. They were trained there by the United States Army at the Command General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. The education is not just about military warfare, though. They also learn about democracy, the United States political system, and strong leadership. Good moral and ethic conduct is at the top of the list of what they learn. And it's an ingrained part of the culture at the fort, along with human rights issues. So how does this help global security? These talented military officers and their families, representing 157 countries to date, have an incalculable contribution to the professional military and cultural engagement that is unmatched anywhere in the world. These leaders come to know us Americans as friends and neighbors, something that cannot be achieved in any other way. We know the type of relationships that are built there span lifetimes, and there have been many cases where conflict has been prevented because one of the officers called their buddy from Kansas and they sorted it out between themselves instead of the countries going to war. Can you imagine? The relationship, the trust, and the education they gained at their time of at Fort Leavenworth has saved lives around the world. In many cases, it's increased the respect for individual human rights and also stabilized democracies. I want to give you an example of the impact of one of these graduates who influenced society both on his way to become president when he was general and then as a two-term president for Indonesia. President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, whom Western countries refer to as President SBY because we have problems pronouncing his name. I had the good fortune of meeting President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, and he presided over the most densely populated Muslim country in the world with 250 people. He turned Indonesia into a democratic society throughout his 8 years of office without a single shot being fired. Compare that to other countries who have suffered violent revolutions to seek true free elections. President SBY said, I had the pleasure to meet him, he said this about having learned so much about good governance and leadership at the Command General Staff College. And also, when I tell you this, be aware of how he thinks as a great leader. He said, I observe the management of a democratic country, the various channels people could participate in politics, the enforcement of the rule of law, basically the way national interests are managed. All this helped me to understand other countries better when working together. To me, the democratization of Indonesia must be peaceful and the reforms must also be peaceful in order to avoid a large number of victims, which would have been too great a price for our country to pay. After growing up in Indonesia and Papua New Guinea as a child 35-something years ago, it is striking the difference in Indonesia today. I secretly thank the Command and General Staff College for having influenced so many people and saved so many lives around the world. The impact of this program has been phenomenal. That is just one country out of 157 officers from around the world. Can you imagine? So I'd like to watch a short video, if we could just move to the next slide, as we welcome their officers from around the world to Kansas City in our beautiful Opera House. Notice all the different uniforms from around the world, and at the end of the video, pay attention to billionaire Clive Palmer talking about the difference of developing relationships with people who are different from you. This point will also help your future. Well, maybe we'll just move on. In fact, President SBY thought the experience in Kansas so valuable, his son also attended the Command General Staff College and lived there with his wife also. So one of the lessons that we can learn from this program is to become friends with everybody. If you know as many people as you can across your company, good security will also come. You will learn more, you'll move up the ranks faster, and you'll be more aware of the risks and challenges around you, no matter what field you're pursuing. People talk and you will know what's going on. Now, if you're shy and don't like to talk much, let me share this one tip to help. Have you ever wondered why some people are more popular than others? Some people are really pretty or handsome, but they're not popular. Some people are really wealthy, and they're not popular. So it's not how much money you have or how you look that will make you popular. After much study, they asked a large group of people to list who they liked in their grade. It turned out that the people who liked the most people on their list were also the most popular. So the moral of the story is, go through life looking for the good in people instead of judging or looking down, and you will have many more friends and enjoy far greater success. So go forward, think like a leader, develop many friendships, and behind the scenes, many of our world leaders are trying to attain peace and stability for international security. I wish you the greatest success, and it was my honor to be here today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Gabrielle, for sharing your views on global security. I now invite Mr. Jeffrey Wheat, Director of Cyber Operations at Qualitest Group, to address the gathering.
Hi, first off, I'd like to thank the university, the dignitaries, the Indian Economic Trade Organization and ASIF, and everyone for having me here today. First off, a bit of explanation. I understand not everyone here is technical, so I apologize. The first part of this will be somewhat technical, being the cybersecurity guy, but I promise at the end I'll pull it back into something that is of value to everyone. Okay, to start off with, I'm like your parents. This is going to be more of a lecture than a speech, okay? And I apologize. I know you just did 3 years of that, and you're like going, oh, no one told me there was going to be a lecture, and now they're talking there's going to be math involved, okay? So first off, I want to give you a little bit of a history lesson in the computer science realm. My degree is computer science. I graduated from University of Kansas in 1986. I've seen it evolve from mainframes down to, you know, the power in your hand is much more than what I started with. So in the beginning, the way they taught structured programming and what you experienced when you went out into the environment was what we call the waterfall development system. Now, I don't know if anyone here has heard of that other than the instructors, but what it is, if you imagine a waterfall hitting a set of layers of well-defined steps before you get an end result, right? So that's how the computer science was done back then. As a part of that process, there was a key role called the systems engineer. Now, I realize to the technical people in the room, systems engineer now usually means someone that's just running a router or whatever, but in those days, the systems engineer was an evolutionary position where you came from being a programmer or an electrical engineer up to a position where you understood everything. You had the global view of what was going on. You understood all the systems that interfaced with it. You understood the hardware side. You understood the software side. That had a few advantages, okay? One of which is that systems engineer always coordinated what was going on so that the programmers down below could focus on their tasks and do the task at hand. The systems engineer was the glue that pulled that all together. At that point, security was instilled by the systems engineer. He controlled it with a thing called the interface control document. Now that sounds okay, it's a document. But what that really did is that defined how everything worked together so everyone was on the same page and understood how that worked. Now in the security world, number one, the weakest spot is always the human, okay? When you move past the human, the second weak spots are what we call are on the seams and at the edges, right? You know, you hear defense in layers, the hard crunchy shell, you know, and that was a model for the past where everything was defended on the outside. So when the bad guys got through the first shell, they ran rampant. Now we're in defense in layers. That's how this works. So that provided that sort of overall security that was in those systems. Now, the security back then, when I say back then, it wasn't that long ago, but there wasn't as much internet, there wasn't as many nation states going after your programs and stuff, so it wasn't as complex to do the security, right? So move forward and look at market influences on the development world. Right, and this is something for everyone to realize, no matter what industry you're in, you always need to understand the business case for why you're there. You may be a programmer, you may be running a hotel, you may be doing fashion, whatever. You work for a company that makes money a certain way, and it comes down to that. You need to understand that function and do what you do to make that function. That's the mission set or the goal of that organization. So always keep that in mind, and I'll come back around to that. So now we went from a waterfall development to what's called agile development. Agile development was driven there by this need for the speed to market. The dot-com boom hit in the 97s, and you could do the, and waterfall development took time. It could take years to get a product. Dot-com comes around, everyone's got to get there fast before the next person gets there with the same idea in front of you, okay? So that was the driving force. Again, a business force for changing how the technology was implemented. In agile development, it starts off with two-week scrums. If you don't haven't learned this in your classes yet, you'll learn it the first day you hit your first company, all right? They're gonna expect you to develop things within 2 weeks. That's called a spin. Scrums are groups that are focused on that spin, and within that group, there's a scrum master, okay? It sounds really bad, but that's what they are, all right? Now, the initial intent when they came up with that was for that scrum master to fill that systems engineering role, okay? So no problem, should have all worked, right? Okay, and I give this the analogy, if waterfall development was designing and building a car, agile development became designing the car while driving it. You can imagine how complex that would be and how perilous that can be, you know, various things. Okay, so agile development, you have the scrum master, should all be right. Problem is, there is such a need for your talents out there that the industry looks for ways to take shortcuts. And one of the shortcuts that I've seen in my experience is that Scrum Master role has turned into more of a program management role. It's more of a manager that understands schedules and how to meet deadlines and push people to meet those deadlines, less about the technology, okay? So what happened in that space was that as those fast developments happened, the security started to fall off. And it became a model of, we'll get the security at the end. And when you think about how a corporation is designed, right? There's development teams, there's testing teams, and then there's the security team, the IT security, different budgets, you know, different the whole thing. So it becomes a concept, or it turned into a concept where the whole thing's designed and still being designed, and it's the IT groups role or position to fix it after the fact. Now I equate that to, would you rather spend 100 rupees getting a flu shot, or would you rather spend $1,000 paying for the doctor and the time off and whatever after you have the flu? Think of that in terms of security. Now, basically that what that does is that exposes your organization to more risk. You're hoping they don't find it before you fix it. And a lot of times you don't, used to be, not that long ago, till CEOs started losing their job, used to be it got fixed after it got found by the bad guy, right? So you know, that created a situation where the corporations are at risk. You know, from a business model that drove the engineering in a direction that it needed to go, but they overlooked the impending doom or whatever, and the black arts of the structured programming, I like to call them, suffered. So when you talk about those black arts, security is one of them, performance is another. In the computer science world, the science of computer science is that performance and security of those systems. You know, you designed it to do something, but the part about getting down into getting an extra microsecond of response out of it is hard. You have to understand how the system works and how it plays together to be able to affect that change, right? So that's where the science is involved in, and with these fast schedules, that will suffer. Okay, so now, that isn't bad enough. Now we still have market pressures to market to deal, so we have a new thing now called DevOps. DevOps is agile development, but what they've done, instead of doing the testing afterwards, which took time, now they've integrated up into while the software is being designed. So now you have a car that's being designed while you're driving it, and you got a mechanic trying to fix it while it's going along. I mean, you can imagine where that'd go. Now, that has the propensity to create an even harder problem for the security people. But I always see challenges in anything you do. Always look at a challenge as an opportunity to perform, as an opportunity in general. Well, in the DevOps world, what it does is, from a corporate standpoint, it forces the C-suite, the executives within the company, who are driving DevOps because they want to get to market faster. They're pushing that testing farther up into the development cycle because they're tired of these stop, jack, and you know, different budgets and whatever. Well, that would complicate the security. However, in this case, if you have to go through the complexity to insert your testing into the development cycles, that's hard. You know, change is hard. And that's a new paradigm, and it's happening at line speed. If you have got the corporate side on getting that done, you have a perfect opportunity to insert the security testing up front. So we have the opportunity to drive the security profile of the applications we're developing up front into the development because there's a corporate business reason to do that beyond just, you know, the time to market. Okay, we have a thing called GDPR that's coming out in the UK, and it's really going to affect India. It affects anyone, any multinational, the US, anywhere, who is doing business in those member states. Because what it's requiring, and what happens is, a lot of times that gets tossed over to the IT group, here, sort this out, just like any other certifications out there. If you, those in the industry, know what I'm talking about. But the problem is, it's really not about IT. IT is going to expose those companies, and I heard Google mentioned earlier, or Facebook mentioned earlier about the data privacy with the Cambridge group, right? What it means is they are going to be responsible for how the data is handled. You're going to have to handle it in a secure way. Now, if security is breached, it's going to expose how you handle that data. If you mishandled it, if you've kept it for 10 years when you should have kept it for one, you know, if you use it for things that the end owner didn't intend it for, you're going to answer for that. So, but the fines in those, so now it's an economic model, right? It's 2%, fines of upwards of 2% of gross product. So whatever a company makes globally, 2% of that could be fined for egregious IT type deals. Now, what they really get fined for, they can be fined up to 4% of total gross, everything you make, this isn't profit, of everything they make if you've handled the data wrong. So it becomes a data privacy issue. It becomes, it's not only about the IT people, it's about your database people, it's about your marketing people that are collecting that data, it's having them all on the same page on what they can do with the data, how long they can keep it. You know, people have the right to be forgotten. You know, there's all these things that are part of the GDPR. It's really going to hit India because there are so many multinational companies here. All you have to do is drive around the loop and count them, right? You've got every Fortune 500 out of the U.S., I'm sure, and you know whatever the other ones are, they're here. So you're going to be dealing with it. So you need to understand it. So this baking the security in, we call it baking it in up front, in DevOps and in your agile development, getting that security in up front is paramount to that because you can no longer wait until you're exposed or attacked or whatever to do that because the financial ramifications are way too high. And now, you know, it used to be you look at Target or somewhere else where a CEO or a CISO failed, they got hacked, you know, they lost their job, okay, but then they found another job. Those days are gone. Now if you get name and shamed in that, you're probably working somewhere in some other industry, you know, like the guy with the music degree, you know, at one of the companies. So anyway, point being is, you know, it's better always, you know, an ounce of prevention is always better than a pound of cure. It's all those kind of things. So it applies in computer science. Now, I realize a lot of you, and that's kind of that's the end of the technical portion of this. I realize a lot of you aren't computer science. So I want to impart some wisdom that I've learned since getting here and I've learned through my career. Gabrielle and I came here December 19th. We've been here since then, came in. We've loved the experience. The amount of talent, the amount of work ethic, we love everything about this to the extent that I'm, you know, as head of our security operations and security services, I'm focusing our major efforts here in India as a result of this. This has been a crash college course in offshoring for me, and it's been wonderful. And we've loved every minute of it, and we're acting on it. I want to share with you some of the things that I've learned, you know, from differences in cultures and stuff in managing people here and stuff since I've been here. In my world back in the States, usually if you're an engineer, you just loathe being a manager. It's just like, it's the kiss of death, you know? It's like, what'd I do to make you mad? Why are you making me a manager, So that's kind of how it is there. You know, I went to college to be a computer scientist, not to manage people. Kind of the way it is here. It's different here. I have people, you know, from the day I walked in asking me when they were going to be a manager, I'm kind of looking at them like, why do you want to be a manager? You know, be careful what you ask for, right? You know, it's like take that 40 hours and turn it into 60, like overnight, right? So one of the things that, you know, and I'm a mentor at heart. I love the fact that you're students because I love to teach. I always teach my engineers, and I always believe, and I teach my managers. I said, you know, the first thing, you know, the way you're going to impress me is how you take care of your people. And the first thing I want you to do is training your replacement, because I always want you mentoring the next leader. I want you to nurture leadership. So one thing to part with all of you in terms of management, you can't just say, I want to be a manager. Your managers have gone through their experience and everything. But what you need to do is understand what is important to that manager. Understand the business case. You know, you're a computer scientist. That's great. What's the business? Is it a brewery company? Is it a whatever? What's important to them? Understand what's important to them and do what's important to them before they ask. What that's going to do, that's going to establish their trust in you. They're going to trust that you understand why you're there. You're not there just to program. You're there to sell beer. You're there to sell computers. You're there to sell whatever it is they sell. As they understand you get that, that is your launch pad into management. That and always look for a mentor. Look for someone like me, like Gabrielle, like anyone who's always reaching out to teach. Be patient. Listen to them. You know, respect their time, because I guarantee if they're spending 5 hours of their day, that's five extra hours a manager is working that week, okay? Because they have plenty to do. So, you know, that's really for everyone in the room in terms of a management standpoint. Always understand what your manager wants first and do it before they ask. You'll go far. Your career will never stop. And so, thanks again for having me. And this is a wonderful university. I'm excited to go back and tell my company about your university. I'm excited to go back and tell my alma mater, University of Kansas, about your company, which has a very extensive international program. My daughter's in it. So we're happy to go back and do that, and we've enjoyed it. You have a wonderful campus here. Make the best of it. This is the most important 3 years of your life. If you take the time you're in college on a yardstick, and you take that one little piece that you're in this university, it represents about 2 inches on that yardstick. But that 2 inches has more to do with your career, your life, where you go in the world, than any other 2 inches on that whole yardstick. So make the most of this time, and best of luck to everyone. Thank you.